What makes someone more vulnerable or more resilient to mental health issues? Is it genetic? Is it temperament? Is it environment? Or all of the above? Hello and welcome to another episode of Psy Week V. My name is Huy, and in today's episode, let's talk about four common risk factors and protective factors in mental health and what does that mean for you. Let's go. Kevin is a 15-year-old American-born Vietnamese who started 10th grade. Kevin had stayed at home with his mom, who provided care for him all his life, but rarely praises him for his good behavior. She frequently gets agitated and yells at him for no reason. In recent years, he recognized that when his mom gets angry, he just has to excuse himself to avoid being yelled at. This happened more days than not, and Kevin finds himself very afraid to be in the company of his mother. He finds comfort to be in a small group of friends at school. Kevin has a distant relationship with his father, who works as an engineer, provided financially for his family, but drinks alcohol after work until he falls asleep.
Let's assume that Kevin's mom is clinically depressed. In other episodes, we talk about clinical depression. And she has not received any treatment. His father drinks alcohol daily. Now, Kevin has both genetic and what we call environmental vulnerabilities. He tends to withdraw when there's trouble, so he's likely going to cope with things passively rather than asserting his needs. He is more likely to be neglected, to feel neglected, and to be taken advantage of by his peers. Because of these risk factors, he is more likely to develop depression when triggers or stressors in his environment comes up, like when he's not doing well with school, when he encounters or the family encounters financial troubles, when he has troubles getting along with his peers, or has difficulties finding intimate relationships. There are four general categories of risk and protective factors. First, biophysical. Second, psychological. Third, social. And fourth, spiritual. Biophysical factors include genetic vulnerability and physical health. The risk factors include family history of mental health problems. Some mental health disorders like schizophrenia and major depressive disorder have a stronger genetic connection. Children of those who have this condition are more at risk of developing the same disorder as their parents. Personal history of traumatic brain injury, TBI. Head injuries can affect your mental health. It is not uncommon to see people who have depression related to head injury when they're young. Chronic medical conditions, typically in older individuals, such as cancer, diabetes, especially thyroid or other brain-related illnesses like Alzheimer's or Parkinson's disease, can be closely associated with mood disorders as well. The second area we want to talk about is psychological factors. Now, this includes mental and emotional factors. The risk factors in this area are stressful life situations, such as encountering financial difficulties or legal problems, traumatic life experiences, such as rape or serving in the armed forces coming back from a war, low self-esteem. Perceived incompetence is actually creating negative viewpoints and perspectives on life. Protective factors under psychological or mental and emotional factors can include reliable support and discipline from caregivers, the ability to regulate emotions, the ability to have good and practice good coping skills, and have good problem-solving skills.
Not only the factors within you, but what happens around you and to you can affect your mental health as well. We call this social-cultural-economical factors. For example, being in an abusive relationship with a parent, a lover, or a friend, growing up or currently living in poverty, discrimination, bullying, either as a victim or as a perpetrator. And for Kevin's case, as an American-born Vietnamese, he has to deal with generational, cultural, and language gap in his household, identity crisis of having to assimilate to a dominant culture. He might even experience inferiority complex. He might feel ashamed of his cultural background, which might push him to denounce one identity in order to embrace the other. Potential discrimination in school and other social contexts. And this happens very frequently to people of ethnic minorities, and it does affect your mental health. And the protective factor can be being born and raised in a stable family with economic, financial security, good peer relationship, participation in sports team, club, community, or religious group. Number four is spirituality. One's spiritual belief or perception of God will affect one's outlook of life. If a person grows up believing that God is a bearded, angry man in heaven who acts as a heavenly policeman, it's not surprising that they would grow up to be anxious, rigid, and judgmental of others, and especially of themselves. They might believe wrongly that they are irredeemable or inherently flawed beyond repair. Protective factor when it comes to spirituality. Research suggests that religiosity reduces suicide rates, alcoholism, and drug use. It gives people a set of structure to explain what happens around them. Religiosity also provides guidelines to live by, which usually includes principles like charity, forgiveness, compassion, gratitude, all of which are very, very healthy. Furthermore, it can also provide community, a sense of belonging, and trustworthy and safe social engagement.
So we want to take the time to talk about the practical implication of what all this means. We all have some risk factors. That does not necessarily mean that the more risk factors you have, that you are doomed to acquire some mental health disorder. Neither does having more protective factor mean that you are bulletproof. There are some factors that are out of our control. For example, we can't choose the family we're born into, or the neighborhood we were raised in, or the trauma someone has caused us. However, many of the aforementioned factors are dynamic, meaning they are not set in stone. They change over time, and we can take action to influence that change throughout our lifetime.
We cannot control what cards are dealt to us, but we are responsible for what we make out of them. For example, we can improve our mental health by improving our habits, changing playgrounds, changing playmates, learning interpersonal skills, talk to a friend, a pastor, a mental health professional. It's all about focusing on the here and now, on what is within your control, do the next good thing, and take one step at a time. A quick disclaimer. So what does this mean for Christians? If all legitimate religions out there provide mental health benefits, then what makes Christianity distinctive? Exactly. What makes the gospel distinctive is not a healthy moral life. It's just a byproduct of our faith. You see, what is so unique about the gospel is about the identity of the God we worship. He's the triune God. God the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. The Father sent the Son into the world in order to give us more than just a moral life, but eternal life. You see, what God wants for us is more than just mental health, but eternity spent with Him, the source of all goodness. And those who confess their faith in Jesus and set out to reorient their lives in accordance to His teaching will receive eternal life by the power of the Holy Spirit. And on the day Jesus comes back, that spiritual reality will become a physical reality. And that's what makes the gospel so much of a good news.
We thank you for watching this video. Thank you for joining us again. We hope that you found the content beneficial to you. Please give us a like and subscribe to our channel. And we look forward to talking with you in the future on other important contents.